When I was a teenager, video games rarely had a save function. There just wasn't any hardware for it. To save the progress, you had to write down a password using a pen and paper. In this series, we crack how these passwords worked. Before 3D graphics, open worlds, or voice acting, there were 8-bit adventures that pushed the limits of imagination and difficulty. One of the most iconic of these is Castlevania 3 Dracula's Curse, released for the NES in 1989. Set centuries before the original Castlevania, this prequel follows Trevor Belmont, a whip-wielding vampire hunter, on a quest to stop Dracula from plunging the world into darkness. Dracula's Curse introduced branching paths and multiple playable allies, each with unique abilities, adding replay value and strategy. It was the return to the tight platforming of the first game after the experimental RGB elements of Castlevania 2 Simon's Quest that I have covered previously in Season 1, Episode 6, but also a departure from the linearity of the first Castlevania. And in Japan, the game was released as Akumajo Densetsu with a richer, more atmospheric soundtrack thanks to a special sound chip inside the cartridge, a feature that never made it to the Western version. The password system in Castlevania 3 works like this. First, you must enter the player name, which is 8 symbols long. Valid symbols are the English letters and space, exclamation mark, question mark and period, for a total of 30 different symbols. Then you are taken to the password screen. On top, there is the name you entered, just in case you need to double check. Then... Actually, the skulls are rather depressing. Can we get something more pleasing, please? Much better. So, the password is a 4x4 grid. In each cell of the grid, you can enter one of the four symbols. Nothing, whip, rosary, and a heart. Of course, computers don't deal with items, they deal with numbers. Each of these items corresponds to a number, 0, 1, 2, or 3. And not just corresponds, they literally are a number from 0 to 3. Now for a computer, it is even more natural to deal with binary numbers rather than decimal numbers. Each of these four symbols is a set of two binary digits. These four combinations, 00, 01, 10, and 11, cover all the possible combinations for two bits. There are no other possible combinations of two binary digits. Now let's have a look at an example password. If we translate each of these symbols into their corresponding binary digits, we get this table of numbers. Remember, blank means 00, whip means 01, rosary means 10, and heart means 11. Now if we pay close attention, we can see that each slot is actually a combination of two binary digits. Let's put little dividing walls to make it clearer. And we get a total of 32 half cells, each of which can have either 0 or 1. Out from these 32 half cells, the game collects a total of 16 bits, one set of 8 bits and another set of 8 bits. I call these two sets the high bits and the low bits. The high bits come from some of these half cells, and the low bits come from some of these half cells. The low bits contain this information, the hard mode. If this bit is set, then the game is in hard mode, otherwise in normal mode. Then the ally number. The ally is 2 bits and has 4 possible values for the 4 playable characters in the game. Then there is one random bit. This bit literally has no meaning other than to make the passwords more random. Then one bit for the stage number, more about that later. And a 3-bit hash for the name, more about that later too. The high bits contain an 8-bit checksum, more about that later as well. Now where do these bits come from? The bits do not come from any of these 3 slots. There must be exactly one symbol in one of these 3 slots. And which one it is and where it is determines the stage number, well, most of it. The stage number attained from these symbols is always even, but the stage bit is added to this number to get a possible odd number. The password must contain exactly one of these 9 options. If it finds 01, that is the whip, in the top left corner, then the two other slots must be blank, which means they must contain a 00, and so on. I call this symbol the key symbol, because the key determines where the rest of the bits are. If a key is found in slot 0, then the game picks the two sets of 8 bits from these particular positions. If a symbol is found in slot 6, these positions are used instead, and if a symbol is found in slot 13, these positions are used instead. Here is the same information as a table. Notably, the high and low bits are always taken from the same cell. The low bit is taken from the left side half cell, and the high bit is taken from the right side half cell. If any cell that is not listed on the row contains a non-zero value, then the password is rejected. Now, about the data items. Well, hard mode is pretty self-evident. If hard mode is enabled, there will be extra enemies, Trevor takes more damage from hits, and you will be stuck with whichever ally you have. Trevor is the main playable character in the game, but there are three other characters you can recruit in the game. Cypher, Grant, Alucard. These allies can be recruited in particular stages, and which ally you recruit determines the path in the game. In hard mode, you can choose any combination of stage and ally, but in normal mode, several stages are barred from having a particular ally. The list of valid stages for each ally is shown on the screen. We already covered the random bit and the stage bit, but what's the name code? Let's study the assembler code to find out. This is the relevant piece of assembler code. Let me quickly translate this into some Python code. First though, we need to deal with a symbol to number translation. This game doesn't use ASCII. Instead, it assigns hexadecimal numbers 50 to 69 to the alphabetic characters, 6A to the exclamation mark, 6B to the question mark, 0 to the space, and 4B to the period. We use a simple substring search to translate the symbols into numbers in Python. Now for the code itself. It produces a single numeric value. Let's call it result. It performs a loop where it processes each of the 8 characters of the name. This character value is added to the result. Also, a value from a supplied list of numbers is added to the result. The supplied list is 8 numbers long and contains 7, 3, 1, 6, 2, 4, 5, and 0. Finally, only the 3 lowest bits of the result are saved using the AND operation. Now, this loop can be expressed much more simply using Python's SUM function. We take the sum of symbols and the sum of adds. Now, the sum of adds is always a constant, so we can replace the sum with 28. And actually, because it is ANDed, we can use 4 instead. Instead of all that assembler code and an 8-element constant table, they really could have done this for the same outcome, and saved 19 bytes of precious ROM space in the process. At least in this password processing code, they really did some things quite the needlessly complicated way. You know, when I initially started researching this code, I began first reverse engineering the password decoder. Bad choice. The password decoder in this game is a lot more complex than the encoder is. You never know before you start, sometimes it's the other way around. But I digress. This is the name hash code, which is really a checksum. So what is this so-called 8-bit checksum then? Let's study the assembler code to find out. This is the relevant piece of assembler code. Let me again translate this into some Python code. So it does all sorts of things with the low bits. You know the 8 bits that we already decoded. First, it chooses a key value, hexadecimal A0 or 50 depending on the random bit. Aha, that's where the random bit is used. Then it separates the two nibbles of the low bits, that is, groups of 4 bits, and puts them in two separate variables. The sum of these two nibbles is placed in yet another variable. Then it performs a sequence of various XORs and adds. Actually, that one's an OR, and adds the stage number to the result. This is quite complicated, but we can make it shorter by inlining the two temporary variables. It is still a bit too long for my taste. Let me rewrite this. First, we will define a function that calculates the sum of two nibbles in a byte. The checksum is constructed by taking the nibble sum of the byte, XORed by the key, and placing that in the low nibble of the checksum, and the nibble sum of the original byte, which is placed in the high nibble of the checksum, and the stage number is added to the result. This is still three lines of code, though. You know what, let's get crazy. I can do better. There. This is a compact expression. I could make this an onliner, but the window is too small. Oh well. Again, they could have made the code simpler. Because the code essentially calculates the sum of two nibbles twice, we could have a subroutine for that purpose. This makes the code significantly shorter than what was there originally, freeing 10 bytes of ROM space. Anyway, this is the checksum, which isn't really a checksum, but a hash. The high bits must match this expression calculated from the low bits and the stage number, or the password is malformed and will not be accepted. Now, what are those stage numbers? Stage 0 is the Warakia villages. Stages 1 and 2 are the clock tower of untimely death. Stages 3 and 4 are the mad forest or the black forest, depending which guide you read. Stage 5 is the haunted ship of fools or the haunted pirate ship. Stage 6 is the tower of terror or the eastern guard tower. Stage 7 is the sunken city of poltergeists or ancient castle bridge. Stage 8 is a murky mash of morbid morons or sunken swamplands. Stage 9 is Alucard's cave or mysterious mining caves. Stage 10 is, I think, still Alucard's cave. Stage 11 is called Causeway or flooded city of dragons. Stage 12 is underground catacombs, I think, or subterranean dungeon. Stage 13 is the cliffside entrance or the jagged cliffside path. Stage 14 is the castle courtyard. Stage 15 is the main hall or the entranceway to Dracula's castle. Stage 16 is the inner halls or the chaotic gardens of Dracula. Stage 17 is the castle keep or the inner sanctum of Dracula. Now let's go through the process of decoding a sample password. Here it is, an example password. First, remember that each of these graphical symbols is really a number. Let's write them in binary. Now let's find the key symbol. Here, it's the one that corresponds to stage 10. So we have made two discoveries so far. The key is in the cell number 0 and the stage number is 10. Next, we find the rest of the slots, and for that purpose, we use this helpful table. Because the key was in cell 0, we use the first row, and we thus populate the bits. From the bits, we can now read the game data. Hard mode is unset, ally number is binary 1-0, which means 2, which means grant. Random bit is 0, stage bit is 0, which means the stage number stays as 10. And the name code is 0. And the checksum is 16 plus 64, which is 80. Let's perform the validations for the password. First of all, there was only one key symbol, check. Secondly, there were no symbols in unused slots, check. Ally is grant, and he is valid in stage 10, check. Now the name hash is 1 plus 0 plus 2 plus 0 plus 6 plus 3 plus 0 plus 4, which is 16, modulo 8 becomes 0, check. Then the checksum. If I quickly run these values through the checksum formula, we can see it produces 80, check. Now mathematically, one can try and enter about 18 trillion different passwords, long scale assuming, but in reality, there are only 8 times 238 passwords in total, and here are all of them. Every single password supported by the game. Now, I totally ignored special hard-coded player names that you might possibly try and enter. Sorry about that. Here is a codec I wrote for this game's passwords. The language is Python. Seems I have been doing a lot of Python lately, even though I haven't yet customized the syntax coloring for it. Partly it's because of my side job at the university, but I can't deny that it's a convenient language for things like this. In the next episode, we will have a look at a well-known NES classic where you can play as a vegetable or a fruit, depending who you ask. Until then, thank you for watching and or listening, and have a nice day, be healthy and filled with wisdom.